Hi again, everybody, moms and dads, boys and girls. You are in the chatter zone. I forgot to write down the number here, Colleen.
126.
You knew it.
Yeah.
126. Our guest is Mary Jane Zuzolo, and you're going to love this episode. We're going to get started right after we begin in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Remember, O most gracious Virgin Mary, that never was it known that anyone who fled to thy protection, implored thy help, or sought thy intercession, was left unaided. Inspired by this confidence, I fly unto thee, O Virgin of virgins, my mother. To thee I come, before thee I stand, sinful and sorrowful. O Mother of the Word Incarnate, despise not my petitions, but in thy mercy hear and answer me. Amen. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Many thanks to our sponsor, Hot Works, over on Holiday Drive.
Hot Works. I saw a car the other day, and it had a Hot Works sticker on the back.
Yeah, I've seen a few of those.
I didn't know they had those.
They do.
That's cool.
At least on a couple cars.
That's cool.
Going around.
Yeah.
Let's talk about your big luncheon coming up real soon,
yes.
May, I'm going to say 8th.
Ooh, very good. Well, I hope you remember, you're the MC. I hope it's on your calendar.
It's pretty hard to say no to Sue Lansing.
It is hard to say no to Sue.
Time you're coming again.
Okay. So Mary's Inn Maternity Home is having our Women of Hope Luncheon on Wednesday, May 8th at the Dubuque Golf and Country Club. And we hope that you can come. If you are on Mary's Inn mailing list, you would have gotten a couple different things by email or
postcards
postal mail.
Postcards and that kind of thing.
Save the date. So it's registration is at 11:30, and then we promise to keep the program to 1 hour.
59 minutes.
Yes, Tom will make sure of that. He's the MC. And the speaker is Bill Mueller, and he's a humorist. So I think it'll be a fun luncheon.
So for those of you who have been there, you don't have to be sold on coming because it's a great time. But if you haven't been there, just give people what goes on for 59 minutes.
Mm-hmm. So during the time, and men and women are invited. I do want to say that because people hear Women of Hope and they think it's only for women. But men and women are invited. And we'll have a speaker there. We'll have an update on Mary's Inn. We have a brand new video to release. It's only 90 seconds. But
wow.
On media from MediaCom, just finished wrapping it up. So I'm excited to show that video. It's a commercial that will be airing on MediaCom. So we'll hear that. And then we always select someone from the community who has done an outstanding job helping moms, women who are pregnant, and giving them hope and helping them with material assistance and a place to stay and things like that. So I don't want to tell who the award winner is, but it's
the whole purpose of the luncheon.
Certainly a deserving woman. And then Art Galoon, we've had him on multiple times.
Sure.
Art Galoon will do the appeal and talk about Mary's Inn and how our friends at the luncheon can help us keep the doors open.
And we have some new doors. We'll talk about that at the luncheon.
Absolutely, we will, yeah.
And then we'll invite everybody from there to, did you say June for the open house?
June 1st, open house. So I hope everybody can come and see how God has blessed us in this new location.
You're going to love it. Anyway, lots of stuff going on at Mary's Inn at Hot Works. Let's talk about Mary Jane Zuzolo.
Let's.
Hello, Mary Jane.
Hello, and thank you for inviting me.
All the way from Kansas.
That's right.
What city again?
Atchinson. It's where Benedictine College is located.
Sure
if
is.
If anyone is familiar with that.
We have a lot of fans of Benedictine College listening here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I'm trying to remember how we got connected. It seems it must have been through Oscar, who got me to Father Carney, who got his book, and you ended up writing the foreword for the book, and now we understand you've got a book, and we're going to talk more about that, and then maybe you can remember. Did I just cold call you, or did you call me, Mary Jane? I'm trying to recall.
We had another mutual friend, Len Hornoon.
Oh, sure, Len Hornoon.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. He was pushing your book last night on the prayer cynicle during the 8 o'clock hour, so we like that a lot. Anyway, who is Mary Jane? Tell us where you've been and what you know and what did you do and what did you think?
Well, I grew up in southeastern Illinois, and Sister St. Pierre, that's what I call Sister Marie de Saint-Pierre, or
yes,
most in the United States refer to her as Sister Mary of Saint Peter.
Mm-hmm.
But her eldest brother settled in Vincennes, Indiana. He immigrated about the same time that she entered Carmel,
right,
back in Tours, France. And so that's where I grew up. And then about 10 years ago, my husband and our family and I moved out to Atchison so that we could more easily send our children to Benedictine College. And so that's how I wound up in Atchison. But yes, the story of how I came to write the book, it did begin, I guess, years ago. You know, Sister St. Pierre was a household name growing up, and we knew the basics about the devotion, but that was, you know, during the 70s, and mm-hmm. Devotions were really de-emphasized, and I think my mother was discouraged by, you know, even some priests and nuns from wanting to research the devotion more. And truly, we were the only ones we knew of at the time that knew about the devotion, and we did not have written materials that we knew about. And then when my grandfather passed away, everything had been handed down to him, and there were a number of books on the devotion, you know, kind of first editions, but they were all in French, except one. There was one that was translated by the Carmelites in New Orleans into English, and it was inscribed to my great-grandfather, great-great-grandfather. And so this was a very fragile and special book, though, and my mother asked that, you know, I try to find another copy. And so this took some time. That was before the time of the internet and wasn't as easy to track down as it would be now.
So which book is this,
okay,
Mary Jane?
This is there's two similar versions, but they are different. The Life of Sister Mary of St. Peter, Carmelite of Tours, and then the other is Life of Sister St. Pierre. And they're both by the same priest and published in the, I think, roughly 1884. And they do give really detailed accounts of her life, you know, her mystical life after her entry into Carmel. And I do love the Golden Arrow book, which most people are probably familiar with, but it just doesn't give the full context of her revelations, and it really doesn't talk that much about her spiritual life once she entered Carmel. And that's when it gets really interesting. And so you know, through the years I would read it, but they were busy years, lots of little kids, and
mm-hmm.
we did homeschool, and you know, but from time to time I'd come back to that, and I was just always struck by the breadth and the depth of the devotion. And then as the years rolled on, I began to realize what a lot of people, I think, are noticing now, and that is its extreme relevance for the times, because a main thrust of the devotion is its use as spiritual armament in the defeat of communism. And you know, that kind of comes as a package deal with all the isms we have had trouble with, I guess you could say, like, you know, modernism, rationalism, moral relativism, and nowadays we have wokeism. But you know, this manifests in our societal norms, our education, government, and even our Catholic faith in some respects. But you know, I guess I notice this too, and it bothered me, one, that there was such relevance, but also that so few people knew about the devotion. It was just sort of perplexing to me, and so I did want to make sure that my children at least knew about the devotion, and that they could pass it on to their children. And so as I began to research more to do that, I guess I just felt called more and more to write on the devotion. And then I guess the big thing that really stands out to me in more recent years is the profound spirituality of the devotion, and how
let's frame that devotion for a moment for those who aren't listening. We're talking about the devotion to the holy face of Jesus, correct?
That's right.
And let's go back to a couple of books you were talking about, because they're you've got a lot of information that you're sharing with us here, Mary Jane. So your mother talked about a couple of books from this beautiful nun, Sister Mary of St. Peter, but she's just not any ordinary sister or nun here. There's a familial connection with Sister Mary of St. Peter.
I see, yes.
Give us some background so that that makes sense to the people and how your family's connected.
Sure. Okay, so she is my great-great-great aunt. And so she grew up in Rennes, France, and she wanted to enter a Carmelite community, and she was eventually able to do this. And you know, her story getting to the Carmelites is interesting and you know, kind of full of some obstacles, even including my great-great-grandfather. He, as I mentioned, had emigrated to America at about that same time, but he needed to pay for a replacement in the army, which was acceptable. Forgive me. It was an okay practice at the time.
So what you're saying, he could get out of the military draft by making a payment.
Yes, that's right. And so,
which was pretty common in the 18th and 19th century.
Yes, that's right. And so his father, who was also the father of Sister St. Pierre, used his funds, and his sisters, who were the aunts, they used their funds. And therefore, they did not have much left over for the dowry of Sister St. Pierre. But she was able to enter through making a novena to Mary, and also St. Martin of Tours was an object of her devotion as well. And then providentially, she left on the feast of St. Martin. She was not supposed to leave that day, but just circumstances arranged it that way. And so that is a connection. And in fact, St. Martin is one of the patrons of the devotion, along with St. Michael and St. Louis the Ninth, King of France. But they're all known for their kind of stalwart efforts in defending the holy name of God.
And we can give some identity to Sister Mary of Pierre. If they don't know the Golden Arrow book, Colleen, I think a lot of people know the Golden Arrow prayer, which is out of the book. And then you mentioned two other books, Mary Jane, that were about or written by Sister Mary St. Peter. Or you say
That's
it so
right.
much better in French.
Yes, Life of Sister St. Pierre, and then also Life of Sister Mary of St. Peter, Carmelite of Tours. And so there are similar versions of, but they are distinct books. And Sister St. Pierre was given these revelations after the French Revolution and kind of leading into the Second French Revolution. And, you know, there was a lot of blasphemous ideology that was concurrent with that revolution, if not more integral to it. And, you know, of course, we had the terrible persecutions of priests and nuns and desecrations of churches and holy places. And then, you know, even more than this, though, was this sort of infiltrating ideology of communism and kind of the Freemasonry and modernism and the post, what would lead to postmodernisms. But, you know, the free thinking of the day that had its roots in the rationalism that went back even to the Enlightenment. And so these ideologies, you know, essentially are all about replacing God's authority with man's own contriving. You know, now we have, like in moral relativism, you know, everybody's deciding what is true and moral for themselves, and this, you know, supposedly can be different than the next person's. And then in wokeism, I think it's really an inversion of these truths and of what is true and moral according to you know, moral law, natural law, and what has been passed down to us in the Ten Commandments and preserved in the doctrine of the faith. And so these are grave offenses to God. And just like in the Old Testament, you know, they would fall into idolatry and irreverence and blasphemy. And they knew the answer was to make reparation. And that is what would, in effect, turn God's face back toward them, so to speak, to allow them to enjoy the blessings again and even their own religion again. And the answer is the same for us today. We only, in a sense, our behavior is worse because, you know, they sort of fell into these sins out of weakness. And yet with these different ideologies, we are overtly choosing to be anti-God or, you know, blasphemous and irreverent and so forth. You know, that's the design from the inception of these ideologies. And so this is all the more a grave offense. And in fact, you know, Christ says in the Revelations that iniquity has never reached such a degree. And that's really shocking because we've gone through lots of bad times, both in the church and in society and various states and governments and so forth. And he referred to deep-rooted impiety and absolute incredulity. And so, in other words, you know, man is either doubting or rejecting God's morality to the point of inventing his own. And so this is kind of the backdrop of why God gave these revelations or messages to Sister St. Pierre to initiate the Holy Face devotion, is to, you know, get an organized way of spirituality, of atonement, of reparation that would be part of the spiritual fabric of the faithful, and so that they can make this necessary reparation. And I don't say that word lightly. That was used a number of times in the revelations that, you know, this is for those that know
the revelations of Jesus to Sister.
Yes, that's right.
Mary Jane, we're coming up on a break here. We've been talking about a lot of things, and I think we'll get into it in segment two with more about your book, Unveiling the Sixth Station of the Cross. And we'll give people the break to remember what is the sixth station of the cross. And we got to tie all of this in here from the French Revolution, modernism, communism, wokeism, and all of that. How does that tie into the prophecies, the revelations of our blessed Lord to your great, great, great aunt over in Reims, France? This is a fascinating book, and it's a fascinating story. We'll see if we can stitch 350 years together in the next 18 minutes. We'll be back right after this on KCRD. We're back. This is the Chatter Radio Show, also the podcast. You can hear these forever on our mobile app and on the, I guess you could go right to our website on your phone. I don't do that, but I guess we could do that. Episode 126. Thanks to Hotworks. Thanks to Mary Zinn for doing all the things there. Let's get back into the Holy Face of Jesus. And Mary Jane, this, I always put the emphasis, it's Zuzolo, Mary Jane Zuzolo over in Atchinson. See, I did it. Over in Kansas. Mary Jane, welcome back.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Mary Jane was talking in our first segment about her ancestor, Sister Mary of St. Peter, and she was a Carmelite nun in France, and some of the revelations that she had. And one of the revelations, one of the prayers that Sister Mary of St. Peter received was called the Golden Arrow Prayer. And I think it's in that little Pietà prayer book. I think this Golden Arrow book is at the Power Prayer Chapel. I know people have seen it. It's not that long of a prayer. And after Sister Mary of St. Peter received the prayer from our Lord, she was given a vision in which she saw the Sacred Heart of Jesus delightfully wounded by this prayer, as torrents of grace streamed from it, from his heart, for the conversion of sinners. And so we think it's important to put this prayer out over the airwaves. So I am just going to pray it right now for all of our listeners. So here we go. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
The Golden Arrow Prayer. May the most holy, most sacred, most adorable, most incomprehensible, and unutterable name of God be always praised, blessed, loved, adored, and glorified in heaven, on earth, and under the earth, by all the creatures of God, and by the Sacred Heart of our Lord Jesus Christ, in the most holy sacrament of the altar. Amen. In the name of the Father, Amen. And of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
What a beautiful prayer.
Isn't it beautiful?
Mm-hmm. It is beautiful. And there's a couple things to take note about that. It delightfully wounds Christ's heart, and he does disclose that the greatest injuries to his heart are those of blasphemy. So again, not recognizing God as the only God, taking the Lord's name in vain, and not holding the Sabbath as holy, but also, the mentality of thinking that we can make our own truth and morality, that we somehow do not need to rely on what has been handed to us in our faith. And
a rejection of tradition?
Yes, exactly. Yes. And so that is important to realize. And, I hope to get into how these current wounds actually renew the injuries to Christ's face. And maybe we can talk about Veronica a little bit and, the first part of the title of the book. And
so you just gave away the quiz there, Mary Jane. What is the sixth station of the cross, Colleen? I knew I didn't have to quiz you. Colleen knows them all. So go ahead, tell them.
Oh, are you talking to me or Mary Jane? Well, yes, we will just clarify and say it right up front. The sixth station of the cross is Veronica wipes the face of Jesus.
Yeah. How did you come That's about right. that for the book, Mary Jane?
Well, Veronica actually plays a big part in the revelations as given to Sister St. Pierre, the messages from Christ. He seeks Veronica's to console him, because as I was mentioning, the various sins of blasphemy, they renew the injuries to his face. They are aimed at the divinity, so to speak, but they fall back upon his face and the renewed injuries as he is the head of the mystical body of our church. And, mm-hmm. and in fact, the face of Christ on Veronica's veil, there's so much to unpack here. I'm going to get ahead of myself if I go down that path, but briefly, in the devotion, the face is supposed to represent the Godhead itself, the divine Trinity. It does also record, of course, the passion of Christ, the injuries he received during his passion, and it is supposed to represent the face of the church or its doctrine. And so there are, injuries, so to speak, against that face, which are, heresies and apostasy and so forth. But back to Veronica, I think a lot of people might be familiar with the Stations of the Cross, and she mm-hmm. was commemorated for her valiant and compassionate effort at wanting to console the face of Christ for just a moment by wiping it with her veil. And in return, he left the exact likeness upon her veil of his image. And because of that, she's known as Veronica, which means true icon. And so the veil symbolizes the merciful love both given and received in the devotion. And it you know, it's sort of the essence of the devotion. And people might be familiar with that term, merciful love, and think of Saint Therese, and for good reason, because we now have the hindsight of Saint Therese's spirituality, which is really hinges so dramatically on the wounded holy face of Christ. And you know, she was immersed in this devotion from the very beginning. She entered Carmel just 3 years after Pope Leo XIII approved the devotion for immediately for the whole world. So he broke from tradition even in doing that. But the veil also reminds us of the veiled treasures, so to speak, which I eventually talk about in the book, which both Sister Saint Pierre and Saint Therese of Lisieux seem to have recognized these tools of, you know, kind of mystical aids in gaining more and more sanctity. They're very much in line with the whole Carmelite tradition. And in fact, it's I always think it's interesting that Saint Anne appeared to Saint Therese of Lisieux. She was a great friend of Saint Teresa of Avila and Saint John of the Cross, the reformers of Carmel. And she assured Saint Therese that her spirituality was very much in line with the Carmelite tradition. And approximately 40 years before, Saint Teresa of Avila appeared to Sister Saint Pierre and not only assured her that the devotion was in line with the Carmelite tradition, but said that the devotion would be the honor of Carmel. And I think that this is really significant because, especially in hindsight, now we have so many saints in Carmel, but we also have doctors of the church in Carmel, and yet these, not any of these were referred to as the honor, but the devotion was. And I think this is also more support for the idea that the devotion is a form of spirituality, and it's you know, very much again in line with the Carmelite tradition.
So this devotion of the Holy Face, it's our Blessed Lord saying that this is a very special devotion, favorite to our Blessed Lord Jesus Christ. And it's in I want to restate some of what you've said to be clear about this, because I think it's so simple, but it's so profound, that our Blessed Lord is asking for this to be done in reparation for the sins of idolatry, of blasphemy, and of profanation of holy days and holy things, which are the first three commandments. Thou shalt have no strange gods, you shall not take the name of the Lord in vain, and keep holy the Sabbath day. But Mary Jane and Colleen, when you talk to people, they say, well, I'm a good Christian. Mm-hmm. I haven't killed anybody. Mm-hmm. And yet, what we're hearing from this devotion, Mary Jane, is that the sins that wound the holy face of Jesus Christ are not whether or not somebody committed a sexual sin, or they murdered anyone, or they stole something. It is idolatry, blasphemy, and the profanation of holy days and holy things that really injure our Blessed Lord. Is that an accurate statement?
That is, and it sounds sort of shocking to say this, but this is just a paraphrase of exactly what Christ said in the Revelations. This is the greatest devotion to make reparation for the greatest crimes. And you know, the greatest crimes, those again are the ones you outlined, that are offenses against the first three commandments concerning the rights of God. And those three will always be the first, and they are the axis of moral law. The other seven, you know, rest upon the first three, though, mm-hmm. as you say, most people are going to be thinking yep. that they're doing great if they just don't do the last seven, or don't sin against the last seven, I should say. Mm-hmm. And then as far as it being the greatest devotion, that sounds so shocking, but it's in large part because it is making reparation and reparation to and adoration of the Godhead itself versus the sacred humanity of Christ. And that's not to put down other devotions. It's just they fit together in different ways. And in fact, this devotion rests significantly on the Sacred Heart devotion. It was sort of found, so to speak, in the Sacred Heart. And, you know, as Colleen had recited the Golden Arrow Prayer, we know even from that prayer that the Sacred Heart is integral in performing these acts of adoration and reparation. And we are to work in the Sacred Heart to do this. And it actually, you know, in some sense, mirrors or continues or is an extension of the Eucharist, a consecration at Mass. We are in that circumstance. We are that sacrament, I should say. We are. It's an offering of God to God. You know, Christ makes himself available as a perfect sacrifice to be offered to the Father, and we are in this devotion not offering our own merits and love, so to speak, but those of Christ, and it's they are sort of residing in his wounded countenance, and that's what we are offering to the Father in reparation. And so again, it's you know, basically an offering of God to God. And these are some of the reasons why it is considered by Christ himself as the highest devotion. And he in fact said that it is to be compared to the miraculous wine served at the end of the wedding feast at Cana versus the common wine of the other devotions, just to give an idea.
Wow.
Wow, that's something. You know, I just think it's so important to reiterate how those first three commandments relate to God. And of course, the greatest commandment is to love God. And so a lot of times when we're talking about sin or what's wrong with the world, we so often focus on the other seven commandments that relate to our fellow human being. And those are important for sure. And in this day and age, a lot of people think of the sixth and ninth commandment and breaking that, but this devotion really highlights the how egregious it is to offend God by the breaking of those first three commandments. And for everybody that says, well, I haven't killed anybody, you know, maybe you say, well, have you missed Mass on Sunday? Have you mm-hmm. taken the name of the Lord in vain? You know, do you put something ahead of God? And, you know, it's just so much worse when you're offending God.
What would be some That's of the right. Common ways that we are idolatrous in this society, that we put something other than God? A common way that we're blaspheming, taking the name of the Lord. And what are ways that we all are offending the first three commandments, but we don't realize it because we think the big ones, I haven't killed anybody, number mm-hmm. five. What would you say to that, Mary Jane?
Well, I think, you know, back to Colleen's point about have we missed Mass on Sunday or Holy Days? And have we worked needlessly on Sunday or Holy Days? And, you know, are we forcing others to work on those days by some of our activities? You know, people, unfortunately, are so used to taking the Lord's name in vain. And you know, this is a very common thing that, you know, if you're surprised by something or angry about something, mm-hmm. You know, to take his name in vain, to say it without proper reverence, anything that takes from God the honor and glory due his name is blasphemy. And you know, certainly we can hold other things as God. You know, maybe we want to place all our trust in our, you know, savings or our work or you know, we just
our health insurance, certain, huh?
Yeah, mm-hmm. right. You know, mm-hmm. we have to have certain material possessions or whatever, that to the point of, you know, taking from God what should be attention that, you know, is rightfully his.
And so I'm going to put you on the spot here. We got a couple of minutes before the break, but mm-hmm. Colleen, this is, we all see this here. I mean, the parking lot at the strip mall on Sunday at 10 or 11 is busier than the parking lot was at 8 or 9 at the church. Mm-hmm. I mean, should we be shopping Sundays?
You know, and that's a great, great suggestion to people if they want to console Christ by this devotion with the Holy Face. Just don't shop on Sunday.
Should we be cutting the grass? Mary Jane, what say you? Should we be cutting grass on Sunday?
No, I think that, and I mean, unless something is truly, truly just like a favorite activity that you just love to cut that grass, and that it, you know, brings you all sorts of consolation, you know, that would be, I suppose, one instance. But I think
I've never had consolation from a lawnmower.
Most people would view that as a chore, and if it can be done another day, it absolutely should be.
So that's the third commandment, and we've hit the second commandment. What about the first commandment? What are the 21st century idols?
Oh, I do think that you know, our devices, we're so consumed with
devices. You mean phones?
Oh, yeah, our digital devices, yes, our phones, our computers, and our social media, and you know.
So there's an idol, or a bunch of idols.
Yeah, we can you know, be, I suppose, anything that we can be in a sense addicted to. You know, really, that's.
Who's gotten in the car? I'm going to ask the two of you. Have you ever gotten in the car and you got two blocks away and said, "I left my phone on the kitchen counter"?
Oh. Absolutely.
Uh-huh.
What happened? Panic?
Oh, my gosh. Panic. Where's my phone? You turn around. And I remember in the days before cell phone, I drove a 9-hour trip without a phone.
Never had
with
one.
Never gave it a second thought. And now you panic if you don't have it.
Mary Jane, we're out of time in segment two. We're going to come back for segment three. And I'm going to put you on the spot. Because this devotion, by way of you and Father Lawrence Carney, who, by the way, is coming to Dubuque in 2025 in March. Father Lawrence Carney tells me this devotion to the Holy Face of Jesus Christ is going to defeat Freemasonry and communism. And you're going to tell us about that and tell us how that's going to come about right after these announcements on KCRD. Back in the studio, well, actually our Kansas studio, with Mary Jane Zuzolo. She's the author of this beautiful book, Unveiling the Sixth Station of the Cross, which is the Veil of Veronica. She also wrote the foreword to a beautiful book with Father Lawrence Daniel Carney, The Secret of the Holy Face. This book's been out. I understand Father Carney's got a new book, because we need another book to read, Colleen.
Oh, my goodness.
And but I don't have that. Mary Jane, do you know the title of Father's new book?
I think it's just Consecration to the Holy Face.
Is that what it is? I haven't seen it yet, and we've only talked by texting. Texting's replaced phone calls these days, Colleen.
It has.
So when we last left, we talked about this. This is not widely known. You talked about the Holy Face devotion building upon all of the other devotions. And so by that, I take that you mean the devotion to the Sacred Heart, the devotion to the Divine Mercy, what other devotions?
Rosary.
The Rosary devotions, things like that. But Mary Jane, you're describing the devotion to the Holy Face as the pinnacle, but there's a promise that's in here, and I know this from your book but from Father Carney, that this is the devotion that will defeat Freemasonry and its evil stepchild, communism, and all the other isms. Tell us about that.
Okay. Well, you know, back to Veronica, I realized I didn't finish one thing about that might help pull in some of these other points, is that, you know, we are like Veronica in that when we offer consolation to God in the form of this reparation, he in return imprints upon our souls the divine likeness. And so we are becoming more and more Christ-like in proportion to the reparation that we make. And this devotion is all about kind of two things combined as one emotion, consolation for God and mercy for man. And so, you know, as we mentioned, the golden arrow prayer, for example, that torrents of graces are released when that prayer is said for the conversion of sinners. And so this, and you know, we won't have time today, but it's a very, it can be as deep a spirituality as you want, and I try to explain that in the book. But it's a spirituality designed by God for the modern era to call men back to proper love and reverence of him. It heals the ills of our time. As Pius the Ninth said, it's a devotion destined to save society. And, you know, I mentioned before, it's the greatest devotion, kind of shockingly stated by Christ, to make reparation for the greatest evil. And again, these are all sins against the first three commandments. And these are wounds that Christ reveals that are more injurious to his heart than any other crimes. And he is ultimately talking about, you know, this deep-rooted impiety and absolute incredulity that we experience at all levels of our society today. But it is very manifest in communism and modernism, Freemasonry, and it's you know, you can think of almost an inversion of truth and morality, like Isaiah in Isaiah 53, or I'm sorry, forget the verse now, but woe to those who call good evil and evil good. Mm-hmm. And that is really what the designs of, we'll pick on communism for now, you know, is designed to work from within, much like modernism. Pius X actually referred to modernism as the synthesis of all heresies, in part because of this desire to work from within to destroy. And of course, communism does destroy outwardly as well, but it certainly shares this tactic with modernism. And so these isms are, again, not just ungodly because of sin and weakness, but they're designed upon atheistic principles to stamp out religion and the image of God and man by taking away individual rights and freedoms and destroying the nuclear family, you know, making us wards of the state, so to speak. And, you know, there's plenty of evidence for this. Marx is known as being proud of the fact that communism begins with the outset of atheism, according to him. And Lenin said something similar, like, you know, communism abolishes eternal truths, all religion and morality. And so in many respects, we in our time are being allowed to experience the natural consequences of our embracing these ideologies at various levels. I think it's, you know, this crisis in the church even is sort of a result of defacing the face of Christ, which I've mentioned earlier, is the face of Christ is considered in one part the doctrine of the church. And so, you know, this gradual eroding at it, even at times from within, it makes the face unrecognizable. It distorts it to that point, and we're talking about even our faith. And yet there is a remedy, and that remedy is reparation. And so it's much like in the Old Testament, you know, they knew that that was the answer when they had fallen into sins against the rights of God. And so the Holy Face devotion, you know, is to repair these offenses and to establish again proper fear of the Lord.
You just said something, the sin against the rights of God. We don't often hear that, Colleen.
We don't, and I'm trying to think what Pope said. I'm sick of hearing about the rights of man. What about the rights of God? One of the popes said that.
What? Can you go deeper on that concept of the rights of God in your research, Mary Jane?
What? I'm sorry, I didn't hear all of that question.
I'm just wondering, in your research for books and other talks, the that whole concept is just strikes me as I'm listening. The rights of God, the offenses against the rights of God. How does that strike you?
Yes, I think that is what is so one of the reasons this devotion is so unique is because it actually is the only one to make reparation for offenses against the rights of God in terms of the Trinity, the Godhead, and other devotions do approach that through making reparation to offenses against Christ's sacred humanity. Mm-hmm. But this one just kind of goes straight to the divinity itself in terms of the Godhead, and so it makes it stand out from the other devotions, and there are other clues too that make this devotion stand out, like it's unparalleled promises and the miracles associated with the devotion. And these are kind of clues, just like the miracle of Fatima was such an indicator of how important that devotion is, kind of making it the crown devotion or apparition, I'm sorry, to Mary. And so, but you had talked about the communism and Freemasonry and so forth.
Yes.
And this gives us hope. You know, there is a way out. This is a way to repair what has been done and to undo it as best as may be. And there is a sense that nothing that we can do on a material level is going to make any difference until we make the requisite reparation, much like in Fatima. There's definitely that sense as well in Fatima. And,
I'm going to ask your opinion. This might not be in basis fact in your research for the book. By the way, I can tell you did a lot of research for your book because of the footnotes. Did you catch all of the footnotes in there, Colleen?
I didn't, no.
It just is footnote on footnote.
Oh my goodness!
But I'm going to ask you, Mary Jane. Is so our Lord is calling us to make reparation to his holy face for offenses against the first three commandments, which is idolatry, blasphemy, and profanation of holy days and holy things. And then there is a conclusion here that says that, God bless you.
Excuse me.
There's a conclusion here that says the holy face devotion will defeat communism and its Freemasonry roots and things like that. So, can I make the statement? I'm gonna go this way here. Is the scourge of modernism and Freemasonry and communism are these social ills of the French Revolution? Are these social scourges a result of the sins against the first three commandments?
Yes, that is made clear that the reparations indicate that these isms, we'll say, are not only grave offenses to the Godhead, but they are an allowed chastisement to call men back and to let them understand that they're going to walk in the way of their own inventions, and as Psalm 81 I think says, and you know, he's allowing that, much like he did in the Old Testament. And so I guess that answers the question about that. And it's
makes me wonder, Mary Jane, we're in an election year. So nobody on the ballot's going to fix all of these social ills. We need to vote for the holy face of Jesus.
Right in.
Write him in. Is that I know I'm taking liberties here, but isn't that what this devotion's all about, Mary Jane?
It is. You know, it's a spirituality designed by God himself for the modern era to restore life and light to the masses. It's it is a means to convert the multitudes. It's amazing. But it also, you know, it's supposed to be a selfless endeavor on the devotee's part, but it also aids in, you know, the devotee's own salvation as well. It's, you know, it's spirituality of co-redemption, of reparation, and it's for those engaged in the seriousness of the age. It provides hope and a means for man to assist in reclaiming all for Christ. And, you know, it complementing Fatima, it's a battle plan to assist Our Lady in the current spiritual war against evil, and yet capping key understanding of the great Carmelite mystics, and especially Saint Therese, and true devotion to Mary, and the promises and revelations surrounding the devotion itself. It is a valuable, a most valuable aid in man's own individual salvation as well.
You mentioned Fatima more than once, and the complementarity. What are some of those parallels? Quick.
Well, they are both really focused on making reparation as the means to heal all that is wrong. And the one, of course, Fatima is making reparation for offenses against Mary. And yet these offenses, you know, against her images, her, you know, perpetual virginity and her as Mother of God and so forth, these are ultimately heresies, which, again, heresies are affronts against the first three commandments, the doctrine of the church. And so, you know, there's that parallel. They both talked about Fatima talked about the errors of Russia spreading if reparation wasn't made, and then this devotion.
Think communism.
About, yeah, the communism, you know, they both really highlighted that souls are falling into hell because there are no one to pray for them, to make reparation for them. And this is shocking to hear, but it ultimately emphasizes the mystical solidarity that we're all a part of. You know, we're all a part of the mystical body of Christ and the communion of the saints. Mm-hmm. And so we have a real obligation. If we know about this reparation, same as if we know about Fatima, we are obliged to use it. And in fact, after Sister St. Pierre was given the golden arrow prayer, you know, she asked our Lord, "Are you making me responsible for the sins of blasphemers?" And then he didn't immediately answer, but later on, it was clear that yes, absolutely. He placed, in fact, upon her all the sins of France. He allowed her to use his merits and love to deal with that situation, but he placed that upon her, and he makes clear that we're all part of this. We're all to work together, and you know, we are to aid our brethren in this way.
And Colleen, a sin of blasphemy against Mary is a sin against her blessed Son. Mm-hmm. A sin against the mother has to be a sin against the Son.
Yep.
Wow.
Yes, I'm sorry. I was just going to mention real briefly that this is an extremely Marian devotion, and a lot of people don't realize that right off the bat. And I talk about that at length in the book, but just to give an idea.
Well, you got Christ... 60 seconds as your length right now.
Okay. Yeah. Christ bestowed this giving to mankind this devotion onto Mary. He gave her a new title, Our Lady of the Holy Name of God, and he made very clear that all the, really? The graces of mercy flowing from this devotion to mankind did flow through Mary. And Sister St. Pierre had a whole set of mystical experiences revolving around this, which are sort of like an entire set of revelations in themselves. And so I think that may help people feel all the more comfortable with the devotion to realize how integral Mary is in it.
That's wonderful. I want to be sure If people are interested in learning more about the Holy Face devotion, because honestly, I don't even know what the devotion is. Like, you know how you pray the Chaplet of Divine Mercy on rosary beads? Mm-hmm. I'm just kind of glimpsing through this book, and there's a chaplet of the Holy Face. I mean, we talked a lot about the devotion, but I don't even know what it is.
Well, we could talk 2 hours on
we
this,
could,
we?
But yes. People can find out more what the devotion actually is by going to Mary Jane's website, which is holyfacedevotion.org, and they can find out more there. And then if they are interested in the book, Unveiling the Sixth Station of the Cross, they can go to sophiainstitute.com and order the book there. But there's so much more to this devotion, so we don't want to just kind of drop it. We want to make sure that we let our listeners know where they can go to find out more information.
Mary Jane, what a pleasure it's been to have you on the chatter on our 126th episode.
Yes.
Oh, it was a pleasure to be here. Thank you both very much.
I regret, Colleen, we couldn't get into this devotion as deeply as we can. Mary Jane, you might have a return ticket to the chatter.
Oh, I would welcome that.
All right. Let's end our episode in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Glory be
to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Many thanks to our folks over at Hotworks. Tune in again next week. We love you.